So I'm sorry, today I don't have any pretty pictures for you. It's going to be just the blackboard. Maybe next time we'll come back to some pictures of waves in the atmosphere and so on. But so last time we stopped at the place where we actually wanted to write down the system of equations that we will use in the remaining three lectures. And these equations are known as the shallow water equations, and they require a certain set of assumptions. That is, you take the fully rotating stratified problem which could possibly be compressible, and you make certain assumptions, because what we want to do here is we want to focus on the role of only rotation. That is, we want to remove the effects of, say, a stratification in the problem. So what we do is, let me write them down. The first assumption that we make, which is probably familiar to you from the lectures on turbulence, is that we assume the fluid is is three-dimensionally incompressible. So this is equal to zero. And once again, note that my notation is such that U is equal to U V W over here. And of course, the other thing we bring in with this is that the density is a constant. So as soon as you assume that the density is a constant, any effect of stratification is just wiped off, right? So this is one thing that we assume. The other thing, which is what gives these equations their name, the shallow water equations, is that we assume hydrostatic balance to hold. And what this means is that if you look at the vertical momentum equation, which basically reads dw by dt is minus 1 by rho partial p partial z minus g, where g is your local acceleration due to gravity. We have said that rho is equal to rho naught, so this is a constant over here. And what we assume is that this guy is essentially zero. That is, the acceleration in the vertical direction is much smaller than the balance that you get over here. That is, the pressure gradient in the vertical direction is basically balanced by g. And this is the statement of hydrostatic balance. And the reason that one can assume this is that we are assuming the fluid to be is a shallow fluid. And what that means is that if you look at the geometry of what we are working in, it's always of this form, that is, the length scales in the x and the y direction, there's the horizontal directions, are much, much larger than, let's say, the height of the domain H. So for example, if this was going to be a simple example of the atmosphere, you know that from the maps that we showed last time, geostrophic balance sort of holds beyond 1,000 kilometers or so. Whereas what is the height of the troposphere? You barely are dealing with the entity of, say, 10 kilometers, at the most 20 kilometers. So this H by L is a number that's much, much smaller than 1. That is, H divided by L is this over here. And if we take the governing equations and we actually impose this over here, we are justified in saying that this balance holds to a fair degree of accuracy. So this is what we will assume in addition to this guy over here. And now I won't go through the derivation of how you get the shallow water equations. A good reference is from the list that I showed you yesterday, or rather the first class, is the textbook by Wallace. So you take the full set of equations, just impose this systematically, it's not very difficult, and you'll arrive at the rotating shallow water equations. So physically, what are we talking about? Well, let's say this is your x, this is your z over here. All we are saying is, we have a fluid that occupies a domain over here. It is of a constant density, rho naught, over here. And for the time being, I'm going to say that this eta b represents my bottom topography. And you can take it to be a smooth function if you want to. There's no harm in that. For the time being, we'll say that this is flat. So you're dealing with a flat boundary. You have a fluid that's going up and down over here. The mean depth of this fluid, or rather the total depth of this fluid, is, let's say, h. The mean depth can be some H naught over here. And if you so choose, you can do a H minus H naught and describe this, this surface by a function eta. But the important thing to note is that this eta is a function of x, y, t. And similarly, your u and v turn out to be functions purely of x, y, and t. Note that w is not equal to zero. In fact, w can be deduced from this over here because these two guys are independent of z. You can just say that partial w partial z is just minus partial u partial x partial v partial y. And you can integrate this over here because this is not a function of z. And this basically just says that if you do an integral of this over here with respect to dz, you will get your w at a given height. So what this says is that fluid columns essentially have no dependence in the properties of u, v, and the height field h, which is also a function of x, y, t. So nothing depends upon where you are in z. So the entire fluid moves as a cohesive column, right? And the column but can stretch and contract, can stretch and contract. And that is precisely what generates the local vorticity in the flow. This stretching and contracting over here. And in a minute, we will come to something known as the potential vorticity, which captures the heart of this mechanism. And we'll see how we come to this, and we'll derive this law in detail, right? But for the time being, the picture that you have to keep in mind is, I'm, let's say, taking a tub with a flat bottom. You can spin it as fast as you want to. It's got a constant density fluid in it. Now, I'm going to say, well, the kind of experiments that I'm going to try to do is, first experiment, I'm going to hit it by some random perturbation and see what happens, what kind of waves are generated. The second experiment will be of the class that goes into the category of turbulence. I'll drive it by some force. The force could be a gradient of some kind, it could be a local stirring, and I want to see the turbulent response of this fluid, which is a constant density fluid that's rotating. Now note that this is not exactly a two-dimensional flow. It's somewhat two-dimensional because u, v are just functions of x, y, but note that the depth of the fluid can change, and more importantly, it's not horizontally incompressible. That is, partial u, partial x, plus partial v partial y is not zero. So there is a horizontal divergence in the flow, which is precisely what gives you this up and down of the flow, right? So it's somewhat between a three-dimensional flow and pure 2D flow. And that's why it shares properties with both of these guys. And when we look at the turbulent behavior of these equations, you will find some properties come from 3D turbulence, some properties come from 2D turbulence, right? Okay, so we are here. Now, one thing that you should always check is, I've written down this over here, and let me now say, let me write it over here. Let me just write the actual equations. So the form of the equations is so this is an x momentum equation. And note clearly, you know that why this has come in this place. In general, you have a minus 1 by rho partial p partial x, right? You have assumed rho is a constant. And moreover, you have assumed hydrostatic balance. So p is going to be related to the depth of the column. And that's exactly what this does. And if you look at the derivation in the book, you will find this done in a systematic way, right? In the same way, what is the equation for V? This is just going to be perfectly of the same kind. And if you actually play around a bit with this condition over here, you can show that this reduces to a very interesting form, which is H div U is equal to zero. And note that this, let me actually make it clear, let me write it as a div H, because this is just the horizontal, not the full divergence, just the horizontal one. And of course, this guy, once again, is the horizontal added advection because there's no dependence on Z, right? So all the terms that involve W partial U partial Z go away. So this guy, just to make it clear, is all of these guys are dH by dt. So it's a horizontal, a nonlinear added advection. And this is a horizontal compressibility. And these equations, and of course, this is your Coriolis term over here. These are the rotating water equation, right? Now, I've said that you can derive these by imposing these constraints on the full set of equations. The first thing that you should check when you're given an equation of this kind is, if you have imposed some criteria, you need to still preserve some conservation laws, right? So what is the thing that you will check first? You have to check that there's some kind of energy conservation going on, because that is what is going to, in the end, guide a turbulent system, right? You have these constraints which you have to respect. So what is the energy conservation for this? This is an exercise that you can try. I'll just write down the conservation law, and you can derive it in a manner that was done similar to the turbulence lectures, where you basically multiply the first equation by U, the second equation by V, the third equation by H, and you'll get an equation for the kinetic and the potential energy. And what you try to show is, let me just write it clearly. So what you should be able to show is the partial respect to time, the integral over the entire domain of E is equal to zero. And this will exactly take the form that if you can just see it, right? If you multiply this and add these guys, you're going to get a divergence term. You're going to integrate over the entire domain. Make the same assumptions that the velocity field either falls off as the domain becomes very big, or you have a periodic domain, so on. So the influx is zero. And Gauss's theorem tells you that nothing really comes in, so this guy is going to be conserved. It's exactly the same form. So you try this out. This is something that is a guiding line for these equations. Now, we come to a statement of, yeah. So let me just write it explicitly over here. So in general, what is, when I say d by dt of u, right? This is partial u, partial t, u. Partial z, right? So when I say d by dt with the subscript h over here, what I mean is just that is only the horizontal added advection. And the reason why this has gone away is that u has no dependence on z. So when I use this short form over here, this is the thing that I'm referring to. Just like when I use div h with a u, all I mean are these two, not the third component also, right? Okay. So in the last class, we wrote down something called the Rossby number, right, which was U by FL. And what I said is that U by L is basically a measure of the vorticity, right, because it has the same dimensions as the vorticity. So this is, in a sense, a ratio of the relative vorticity to the planet, yeah. So you'll have to be a little careful in this because, so if you write down the potential energy F as rho gh, right, this would be a potential energy per unit volume, right? Now note, in this fluid, there's really no unit volume. Everything is per unit area. So you have to consider energy, a kinetic energy density and a potential energy density, which are actually per unit area and not per unit volume, because every column behaves in a cohesive manner. So to account for the fact that you have to take the account of the energy of the entire column, you integrate this with respect to Z and you get H squared by 2. In the same way, you get this H out here, right? Okay. Yeah. So, right. So you need a measure of the relative vorticity to the planetary contribution. Now, in this flow over here, basically your U and V are strong, and in fact, U and V are independent. W is just a slave of U and V because you deduce W from U and V, and it's going to be much smaller than U and V. So the dominant contribution called the component of the vorticity is also the upward component, right? So the out of omega equal to omega X, omega Y, omega Z, it is this guy that's going to be the dominant term over here, and this is precisely in the direction of, so this is a, if a planet is over here, this is our omega, our local Cartesian system sits over here, this is where we are writing our water equations, this is omega sine phi over here, and this is precisely the direction in which you will have omega z, the local normal, right? So what we want is an estimate of omega z. What is omega z? That's just partial xv minus partial yu, right? So your omega is equal to del cross u. So the third component is just this guy over here. How do you get an equation for this guy? Well, just take, do a partial respect to x of this, do a partial respect to y of this, subtract them, you'll get an equation for the evolution of this guy over here, right? And what does that read? That equation reads, so you're going to do a partial respect to x of this guy over here, and you're going to do minus partial respect to y of your and this is going to be equal to some RHS over here. Now in this, if you use the equation, you can show that what you will arrive at is this is just 2-3 lines. That is, do this subtraction over here, use the fact that the divergence is given by this guy, and you should immediately get this law over here. And this quantity over here, omega plus f by h, is the potential vorticity of the shallow water equations. And the equation has the form d by dt. Once, of course, I keep forgetting this, but these are all dh by dt, right? dh by dt of p is equal to zero. So what is the meaning of a law of this kind? This says that the quantity, what we have defined as the potential vorticity, is conserved as a parcel moves along the flow. That is, along with advection, this guy is conserved, right? Now, you might wonder why this is called the potential vorticity, and I'll give you one guess as to who named it the potential vorticity. And once again, you come across the same gentleman by the name of Rossby. So he basically wrote these equations down in the 1920s, and of course, he wasn't really worried about an ideal case of a fluid that has a constant density. His picture was more along the lines of weather maps. So what he was looking at, so the way in which people still look at and used to look at weather maps are contours of constant pressure, right? That's, so they would see how these contours of constant pressure change from day to day, and that's how they would basically tell you that the low pressure system is coming, high pressure system is coming, you expect rain or not, and so on. What he was saying is, well, consider two surfaces of constant pressure, and let the thickness of that surface be h. And so his claim was that the entire dynamics of these pressure systems can be understood by looking at variations in the thickness of two layers, or the one layer that is squished between two contours of constant pressure. So you look at how this thickness changes, that is going to induce a vorticity in the parcels, and that is basically the dynamics of the system to first order. And his claim was that is how you should understand dynamical meteorology, rather than the old school, which was look at fronts and how fronts will move and so on and so forth. He said this is the unifying way to look at things, right? And the way in which you can clearly see this is if you just draw a simple sketch, right? So if you come here, you take your fluid, right? You consider a set of parcels that make up this column over here. The height here is, say, H1. Let's say we are at same latitude, so phi is equal to phi naught. The column hasn't moved in latitude. It's the same latitude. What happens if it goes from here to here? Well, clearly you see that F is the same. Now, omega by H, d by dt of this is conserved. So the parcels that have gone from here to here are essentially going to be stretched up. And therefore, to conserve this guy, they have to start spinning faster, right? And that's exactly what he said, is that you look at these layers of constant pressure, and wherever these layers come together or they go apart, you can see what is going to be the motion of the air around this. And these are all very large-scale motion, because essentially we are talking about winds that are going to be deduced from the pressure contours because of geostrophic balance, which we saw last time, right? So he said the large-scale dynamics of the atmosphere can be contained in this one simple statement right here, right? Now, what did I want to do? So he said that H has the potential of changing the vorticity. So he said that if you move from place to place where the thickness of a layer changes, that thickness has the potential to change the vorticity. That's why he called it the potential vorticity. It's not a very nice name, but I guess it was used in one paper and it stuck from there. So this is called the PV from now on. Right? Let me see. Okay, so one thing that I wanted to show you first is that see, you might think that we have derived these things for this very simple set of equations, which is a constant density fluid, but actually, the PV is an invariant for the full three-dimensional equations that are rotating, stratified, compressible, and the form of the PV there. So if you go back, so if you forget the water equations, go to what I call the full system. So this is rotation plus stratification plus compressibility, you have something known as the Ertel PV, named after Hans Ertel. And this was a remarkable paper that came out in the 1940s, where he showed, under no assumptions, but just a normal fluid, you can show that d by dt of P is equal to 0, where P is equal to omega dot grad lambda by rho, where lambda is a scalar such that d by dt of lambda is 0, and lambda is what you call a thermodynamic function. That is, this is purely a function of temperature and pressure. And in fact, if you take this equation right here, and you impose the conditions that I put to derive the shallow water equations, that is, hydrostatic balance, and make rho equal to constant, you can actually show that this guy reduces to this thing over here. Now, of course, this was derived by Rossby in the 1920s and 30s. This was derived by Ertel in the late 40s. People saw the connection between them much later. But it turns out that this is nothing but a subset of a more general conservation law over here. And when you have other speakers who will come later on in this lecture series, such as John Luke and so on, who are experts on Hamiltonian dynamics, they get very excited when they see something like this, because this is a conservation law that is related to a symmetry. It is a very novel symmetry that is obeyed by fluids, something known as the particle relabeling symmetry, and those guys do all kinds of things with it. So when he comes, you can bother him about that. Okay? So what we have said is that there is a conservation law of this kind, which is a material conservation law, which is inherited by the shallow water equations. And for the time being, I'm going to leave this. We will come back to it when we come to something known as quasi-geostrophic dynamics, and we will see that QG dynamics, in a sense, is nothing but the dynamics of PV. And it's not an overstatement to say that large-scale atmospheric dynamics is simply the dynamics of potential vorticity. It's a very, very central theme in all of GFT, right? Yeah. No. So this is full. This is take your fully stratified rotating system with no assumptions. Of course, there's no dissipation and so on. Otherwise, you'd get a dissipative term in that case, right? So lambda can be any function that is conserved. So for example, a common choice in the atmosphere, if you want to use this for atmospheric applications, is lambda is equal to theta, something known as the potential temperature. So people here who have done courses in atmospheric science will know what this guy is. It's nothing but a scaled form of, so for ideal gas, you can scale, because the atmosphere is compressible, you replace the temperature by something known as the potential temperature. That guy is clearly a function of only T and P, and when there is no additional heating given to the problem, d by dt of theta is equal to zero, and thus this qualifies to be a scalar of this kind, and you can just do omega dot grad theta by rho. And this is the most common form of the PV used in atmospheric dynamics. People who work in oceanography do not like this guy. They have something that's more related to the salinity, right? So they will choose something that will come from that viewpoint. But for atmospheric dynamics, this is a very common choice, right? Okay. So that is actually a tricky thing. That lambda is actually related to just the height of the column. So what it comes down to is, it's a little tricky to derive. I can show it to you maybe after the class, but it turns out to be a simple function that just relates to the height of the column. So it's not conserved in 2D, but you'll find that you can actually manipulate it a bit to get a conservation law. Okay, it's a nice little trick, but it requires a little bit of work. Okay, so we are happy. We have, what is the time? Okay, it's half an hour is gone. So one related point that you should note is a consequence of a material conservation law is global conservation of some related substance. That is, if I have a quantity is equal to zero, right? Now, once again, I'm not talking about the shallow water system in general. If I can say that d phi by dt is zero, right, this implies that is equal to zero, and all I can do is I can use the fact this guy over here to show that is equal to zero. All it is I'm just taking this guy, I'm just taking d by dt of rho phi, expanding it out, using this over here, and then plugging this guy in. I have this. Now you integrate over your whole domain. Once again, all the terms that have a divergence will go away, and what you get is that the integral of rho phi over the entire domain over here is equal to zero. That is, associated with the material conservation law is the global conservation of some substance, which is the density times this guy phi, right? So similarly, just as the PV is conserved over here, you can define something which people very bluntly call the PV substance, which will be nothing but rho times P. And this guy is going to be zero over here. But note, does this imply this? This implies this, but does a global conservation imply material conservation? No, because this is actually much more strict, right? This is on every parcel. This is a global law. You're saying when you integrate over the entire domain, something is conserved. This is much more strict over here, right? So material conservation laws, that's why, play a very strong role, because they have very, very tight constraints on what a fluid can do, right? Okay. So now we have our equations, we have verified energy conservation, and we have gone off on a bit of a tangent and derived something called PV, which is not very clear to us. It will become clear a bit later in the next lecture and so on, especially when we look at QG theory. But what do we do with this? These equations are there. How do we understand their solutions? One idea is to go the route of turbulence, which is the very difficult route. Right? Those are very, very difficult problems where you say, you have this fluid, I'm going to stir it, and now I want to know the statistical properties of the solutions. I want to look at the spectra, the PDFs, and so on. And that comes under the realm of geostrophic turbulence, or rather rotating turbulence. Right? The other avenue is to say, well, let's not jump into the deep end of the pool yet. Let's look at linear theory. What happens if I perturb these equations slightly? I choose a base state that is of interest to me. I perturb things slightly. What I want to know is, what are the classes of waves that are supported by these equations, right? So if I perturb a fluid slightly, that's the expression that I'll get. So our next aim in this class will be to look at the kind of waves that are supported by the linear water equations. But for this, we'll first have to linearize the equations, right? So let's do that. Let's begin here, I guess. So once again, I'm going to give you a very, very simple view of linearization. It will be in much greater detail by Rama in her classes on stability. What our aim is that you basically say that your variables, let's say you're talking about the U component, can be split into two parts, where UB is what I refer to as the base state, and U prime is the perturbation. And the aim is to study the evolution of the perturbations. And of course, the base state has to satisfy the governing nonlinear equation. So the base state is the art of linearization. You choose your base state. And by definition, in some sense, the base states are usually simple because they actually have to be solutions of the equation. If you could write down complicated solutions of the equations, you really won't have to do any of this. The problem would be solved, right? So what you can really put down are simple states. What is the simplest state? The simplest state is one of rest. You say the fluid is just sitting there at a constant depth. My shallow water fluid is in this tank. It's not doing anything. I'm going to come and perturb it. So my U base is going to be zero. My U prime is going to be some small perturbation. So in that case, I'll say V is equal to V base plus V prime, H is equal to H base plus H prime, and your U base, V base are zero, H base is some H naught. It's a constant height fluid that's just there. I'm going to hit it. What's another choice you could make for the base state, which is a very common choice in atmospheric sciences? Well, if you look at weather maps, so you look at the flow in the atmosphere, you find that usually you have a fairly strong jet stream that's going from west to east, right? So people want to understand what is the behavior of waves that are riding on this jet stream. So the base state is your jet stream. So you'll choose an idealization of your jet stream, which could be that, let's say V is zero, there's no meridional motion, north, south. U can be some kind of a shear flow. So you can say U is equal to U of Y, and H is going to be correspondingly in geostrophic balance. Right? And that's your base state. That will satisfy the governing equations, and you're going to perturb that. And the waves that you get as a result of choosing a base state can vary significantly from base state to base state. So when you talk about linear theory, it's always tied to some reference base state. You can't say my linear solutions are this, and that's it. The linear solutions are this with respect to some base state. Right? So for us, the simplest choice is going to be what we'll begin with is that the base state is one of rest with a constant height fluid, right? So let's see how this actually works out. And oh, of course, the main assumption of linear theory is that wherever you get terms of the form that have the product of two primes over here, these are neglected because we are dealing with small amplitude solutions. So this perturbation has a small amplitude. So we say any product of perturbations can be neglected. That is essentially the linearization. So let's see how this works out. Let's take our first equation over here. So you have partial U, partial T. This is the X momentum equation. What I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and put this split in over here. This is going to become a bit of a mess, but okay, let's write it down once. Minus F V bar V base plus V prime equal minus G partial respect to X of H base plus H prime over here, right? Now, of course, we are going to say that the base state has to satisfy the equations of motion. So clearly, you can see that terms of this kind, U base, partial respect to X of U base. So this guy over here, this guy over here, this term over here, and this, I'm just going to cancel out because that is the balance that you have in the base state. Now, the other thing is, products of this kind are going to be discarded. Where do you get a product of this kind? Well, let's look at this. You have a U prime, partial respect to X of U prime, right? So this guy is going to get neglected. In the same way, you have a V prime, partial respect to X of a U prime. So this guy is going to get neglected. Everything else stays behind. So what you're left with is, partial X, right? So I've just dropped these terms over here. This is what you're left with. And now is the time to choose your base state, right? So if you're choosing a jet, you would have to choose that over here. My choice is the simplest choice you can make, that U base is 0, V base is equal to 0, and your H base is equal to some H naught over here. So of course, if this goes away, all of these guys nicely go out over here. And all I'm left with is partial U prime partial T minus F V prime is equal to minus G partial H prime partial X. Everything else has gone away. So I've asked, well, basically I've just dropped the non-linear term. That's what it comes down to, right? So partial U, F, and H. In the same way, you go ahead and do it for the other two equations. And what you will get is a system of three equations that reads. So the first equation we just saw is similarly, the V equation takes exactly the same form. And try this out as an exercise. The H equation will take the form. Is equal to 0 over here, right? So this is of a linear set of shallow water equations that are rotating with respect to a state of rest, right? Now, why are we very happy with this? Because if we choose F to be a constant, then we basically have a set of three linear constant coefficient partial differential equations for which we have a lot of tools to do some analysis, right? So here is where you have to choose what F is going to be. And in a local Cartesian system, there are two common choices for F. The first is known as the F-plane approximation, where F is the constant, just equal to 2 omega sine phi. So what this means is, we're sitting on the globe over here, you're at a latitude phi, your local Cartesian system is here, and we are assuming that our motion is not too large in phi. That is, the meridional excursions are not very large, so they don't really feel much of a change in the Coriolis parameter. So you can get away by saying that F is a constant, and where sine phi is your local phi. That's the first approximation you can make. The second approximation is to say, well, the scale of these motions might be a little bigger, so they do actually feel the variation in the Coriolis parameter, and you basically expand this guy in a Taylor series and retain the first term, right, where your beta will be nothing but 2 omega plus phi by the radius of the Earth, right? So this would be beta. So just to give you an example, if phi is equal to 45 degrees, we saw that F naught is approximately 10 raised to minus 4 second to the minus 1, and beta will be approximately 10 raised to minus 11 meter to the minus 1, a second to the minus 1. Yeah. So all I've done is I've taken this guy and said, you Taylor expand this. Right? So you're moving a distance y, so you just get partial this, partial phi, so that's the cos phi by r, and y by a is just this guy, right? So these are the, and this guy is known as the the beta plane of approximation. So the F plane approximation with a constant F naught, the beta plane approximation where F is equal to F naught plus BB theta Y. Now note, this is sometimes called more specifically the mid-latitude B beta plane, because we always assume that F naught is bounded away from zero. That is, we don't want to come near the equator. That causes a fair amount of difficulty in our equations. That's why equatorial dynamics is in some sense very special as compared to traditional geophysical dynamics. Traditional GFD was developed in the context of the mid-latitudes, where they didn't really care about what happens when F naught becomes small. You look at this, for example, I'm dealing with these equations over here, and I choose to use the beta plane of approximation. So in the mid-latitudes, I'll say, well, F is F naught plus beta Y, I'm happy, because F naught is bounded away from zero. What happens if I use the same equations to describe the tropics? Now, the character of your equation changes, because from going from F naught plus beta Y, your F naught actually tends to zero. So the character of the equation changes completely. The kind of solutions you get are very different from the solutions you expect in the mid-latitudes. So in fact, tropical dynamics tends to be a much more difficult problem than mid-latitude dynamics, but sort of counterintuitive, because mid-latitudes are the places that are influenced strongly by rotation. So you would expect that to be different from a common intuition. But in fact, tropical dynamics tends to be very, very rich. And it's just recently that tropical dynamics has really become the focus of GFD, and a lot of progress has been made in even understanding linear waves of tropical dynamics, which were put down in a pioneering paper by someone called Matsuno in the 1960s. And by Gill in the 1980s, they've really, really been revisited in great detail in the past 10 years. And that's a very, very rich field of work right now. But as you can probably guess, when you come to the tropics, there's one more thing that creates a big problem. And that is, all of this is, in a sense, dry GFD. There's no moisture. In the tropics, moisture is a driving force for a lot of things. Very important to understand what is happening to moisture, how moisture couples with this, right? So therefore, problems involving such simple systems which you couple with moisture are what is currently being done, as I could even call it one of the forefronts of tropical GFD, right? So these are very, very active areas of work. Even though this might look like a very simple set of equations, they contain a lot of physics, right? Okay. How much time? Okay, I have 15 minutes or so. So these are our equations over here. And as you can guess, we will start off with the simplest possible choice, that is F is equal to F naught over here. So basically, you have a constant coefficient set of linear partial differential equations. How will you analyze these? Let's assume that the domain is periodic or infinitely large, as far whatever you want. You will basically substitute a Fourier series, right? You will say that I want to look at plane wave solutions of this, and I want to look at especially the dispersion relation of these plane waves that will characterize the kind of waves that are inherently supported by the shallow water equations without any influence of boundaries and so on, right? So let's do that. So the problem that happens is, so you will have a F naught, this is beta Y. Now as Y goes to zero, that term goes away, right? So the character of the equation changes a lot, right? You're not maintaining the same character of the equation in different parts of your domain. And that becomes a little difficult to handle mathematically. It's not very difficult to handle, but it's of a different character than this, right? Okay, so let's do our plane wave solutions. So what we are going to say is, these are our equations, and all the fields are going to take the form, say for example, U is going to be equal to the real part of some U hat K e raised to ikx by my sigma t over here. In the same way, you're going to have a form for V, you're going to have a form for H prime, so this is U prime, V prime, H prime over here. And the central goal is that you want to derive this guy over here, right? Because for a plane wave, without any constraints, what is e raised to ikx? This is nothing but your spatial oscillation. What is e raised to I sigma t? This is the oscillation in time. There's no relation between them. What these equations do is they tell you, well, no, there has to be a relation between them. That is the only kind of waves that satisfy the physics of the problem. And that relation is this. It tells you that sigma is related to k in some way, so the temporal and spatial oscillations go in some coherent manner, right? Then this is the guy right here, right? So we want to derive this with this kind of a form of our equation. And also, everything in the domain is homogeneous, isotropic, stationary. These are all assumptions that have been made. It's the simplest possible choice. You put this guy over here, what's going to happen? This set of three partial differential equations is going to become three algebraic equations, and we are going to solve those, right? Should write them down. I think I have them written down here. Yeah, so you can verify this for yourself. If you go ahead and substitute a plane wave kind of a solution in there, you should basically get this thing over here. Right? Because your partial respect to time has basically gone to minus I sigma, partial respect to X has gone to I k X, and your partial respect to Y has gone to I k Y. So that's all you've done. You've put this in over here, and you collect them in this form over here. If this equation is to have non-trivial solutions, the condition is nothing but that this matrix A, its determinant should be equal to zero. So you go ahead and do this. You will get a third order polynomial. I won't torture you with the form of the polynomial. We'll write down the answer. If you write down the characteristic polynomial, what you get is is equal to zero, and the solutions that you get are, one possible choice is sigma is equal to zero, and the other possible choice is sigma is equal to plus minus root of f squared plus c squared times k squared, where c is equal to root g h naught, and your capital K squared is nothing but kx squared plus ky squared over here, right? So these are the three answers that you get. So what we are saying is, if you take a shallow water system which is rotating, it's at rest, I perturb it, the only plane waves that are supported by the system fall into the category where their dispersion relation is of the form either sigma is equal to zero or sigma is equal to this and this over here, which is plus minus f squared cc squared k squared, right? Now, our aim will be to look at some properties of these two guys, right? This guy turns out to be extremely interesting, even though it seems as though it would be very uninteresting. In fact, this is, to a large extent, the potential vorticity of the flow. That's what it will turn out to be. These guys are sometimes referred to as the external gravity waves because you have no stratification, so there are no internal gravity waves. These are external gravity waves. And when you quantize the problem, that is, if you put meridional boundaries, these waves get quantized, and they are called Poincaré waves. So because Poincaré was probably the first guy who looked at these in great detail, right? So we will look at the dispersion relation of this graphically of this. But first, what are the properties of this sigma equal to zero mode? Well, right. So you take the equation that you have over here, substitute sigma is equal to zero, and you can get various relations between u, v, and h. And those relations read, so for sigma is equal to zero, if you go back and substitute, you get so what I'm going to do is I'm just going to call this eta hat instead of keeping the primes. And note that this v prime I've just called v over here, okay? Is equal to zero. right? So this you can just read from here, right? All I've put is this guy is equal to zero, so h I k x u hat, h I k x v hat is equal to zero. Put the sigma equal to zero, so you get f naught u hat, g I k x h hat. Put sigma equal to zero, you get f naught v hat and a g I k x h hat, right? That's all. These are the three. Now, let's move these to physical space. What is this? This is, We'll see that. I'm just saying that, you know, we'll see it when we actually look at its statistic features, and we'll see the features of this guy, and you will precisely see that this is the PV, right? So I'm just telling you that right now. We'll see it in a bit, right? So what is this? The third equation, it's nothing but H, partial respect to U, partial respect to H, partial V, partial Y, right? So all that it says is partial U, partial X, plus partial V, partial Y is equal to zero. So the sigma equal to zero mode is horizontally incompressible, right? Secondly, what do these guys tell you? This is nothing but V is equal to G by F and U is equal to minus G by F. Nothing but geostrophic balance, right? So the sigma equal to zero mode is a mode that is horizontally incompressible and is in geostrophic balance, right? And that's where you see that this is going to be the guy that we want to focus on, because we saw from our maps that the large-scale atmospheric circulation or the patterns we saw were in a state that was very close to geostrophic balance. So this guy is going to be the guy who is going to be determining those patterns, right? So this is a mode that is in geostrophic balance, horizontally incompressible, and as you can guess, it is called the geostrophic mode over here, right? In fact, some fluid dynamicists also call it the vortical mode because it contains the PV, so you get the vortical name. But we'll just refer to it as the geostrophic mode. Now, okay, so what I'll do is I'll quickly write down the corresponding, actually, there are only 5 minutes left. So what I'll do is I'll stop here. In the next class, let's go on to a few more properties of these guys and contrast them with this over here. And what I would like to point out is there is an inherent scale separation in terms of the frequency between these guys and these guys, which you can just see from here. What is a lower bound for the frequency of this guy? F. Right? Whatever you do to k, you cannot go below f. So this has a lower bound of f. This is at zero. So there's always a scale separation. So the aim will be to try to isolate that low frequency motion and see if we can extract a simple set of dynamical equations that only govern the motion of that guy. That's not an easy task. You have a nonlinear set of equations that has two scales. We want to extract the dynamics of one guy and see if we can write down a set of equations for that. That equation will be the QG equation. And that is essentially one of the central themes of GFD, right? So that we'll take up in the next class. And of course, once we do that, this guy turns out to be a little restrictive. We will move from the F plane to the beta plane over here. And that's what opens the door to the so-called Rossby waves. Okay, so right now I'll stop here. Of course, if you have questions, please go ahead. Excuse me? So that will come in the fourth lecture. So you've gone beyond linear theory to nonlinear theory. What I'm trying to do is I'm trying to do a bit of linear theory first, and we'll see the nonlinear effects in the fourth class, which will include the jet stream. How is a jet stream formed? And it turns out to be, in fact, it's a very interesting problem because there are multiple views which are not necessarily inconsistent with each other, but there's no accepted one clear way of saying this is why a jet stream formed. It is, of course, due to the rotation of the planet and upscale inverse cascade of energy. How that energy gets diverted to zonal modes is a question that a lot of people have, it's not quite settled, but there are a lot of ways in which one can explain that. Another thing that plays a role there is Rossby waves. We will show that it's a very interesting thing. If you take a rotating system on a beta plane and you stir it at some point, you will create Rossby waves, and those Rossby waves will spontaneously create a jet. This can be shown just by hand, and that is due to the nonlinear momentum flux by the Rossby waves. So that also ties into the inverse transfer of energy that takes place in the beta plane equation. So these things are all sort of part of the same puzzle, but we'll hopefully come to it in the fourth class. Okay? Anything else? Yeah. Huh. All right, so all we are saying is that we are just taking a Fourier transform of this over here. So you're representing your U as U hat K, right? Same way for same for phi, same for V, same for H, and so on. And we are putting no constraints on this. That is, K and sigma, you are not saying that, so the medium is essentially the same from one place to the other. The medium doesn't change with time. So we are sort of, this is a very, very ideal kind of a system, and that is the plane wave. And this is the constraint that comes on the plane wave due to our equations. That's it. Okay? Of course, I'm here for some time, so you can ask me anything afterwards too, okay?